Good morning and welcome to Lutheran Church of the Resurrection. I'm Pastor Karen Paul.
I'm Pastor Kelly Neiman Anderson. It is a blessing to worship with you today.
We are excited to be here with you. Just a reminder, there are a lot of things happening in the life and the ministry of the church, so please make sure you check out the electronic copy of our Cross newsletter that's available, that came out in email. It's also on our Facebook site as well, so just check that out for things that are happening.
Yeah, so in the Cross this week, there was information about the summer calendar for 7th through 12th grade youth. If you have any questions, just let me know. And a reminder that because we have a mission trip coming up in August, we are grateful for our R&S meat sale. Everything's due today, so if you didn't get it in, please contact the church office tomorrow. And if you haven't had a chance, go ahead and click over and watch Sunday School right after worship. We've still got a few weeks left.
Yep. That's a lot of the things that are happening. Know also that the summer schedule will be changing on Memorial Day weekend, so please take a chance to look at that schedule. It's on our website under worship, and we'll be sending out some information as well on a postcard just to keep you informed on what's happening. So we look forward to that.
At this time, we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. People of God, in this Easter season, we remember our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life. And the church celebrates his glorious resurrection.
In our celebration, we share in his victory over death as we hear his word and partake of this meal.
Alleluia! Christ is risen!
Christ is risen indeed! Alleluia!
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation.
Amen.
Refreshed by the resurrection life we have in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism.
We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new. Lead us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us in these grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers.
Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ.
Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life.
To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Now may we join in our opening hymn today.
Can do. Christ is risen, get you gone. God the first and last is with us. Sing Hosanna, everyone.
Let us pray together. O God, you have prepared for those who love your joys beyond understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceeds all we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus delivers a final testimony to his disciples to help them in the days ahead. Here he repeats the most important of all his commands, that they love one another. Jesus said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends. If you do what I command you, I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from Acts in the 9th chapter today. Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priests. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way he found there. He wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. As he was approaching Damascus, on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. He fell to the ground and he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but saw no one. Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. He remained there blind for 3 days and did not eat or drink. Now there was a believer in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord spoke to him in a vision, calling Ananias. "Yes, Lord," he replied. The Lord said, "Go over to Straight Street, to the house of Judas. When you get there, ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is praying to me right now. I have shown him a vision of a man named Ananias coming in and laying hands on him so he can see again." "But Lord," exclaimed Ananias, "I've heard many people talk about the terrible things this man has done to the believers in Jerusalem. And he is authorized by the leading priests to arrest everyone who calls upon your name." But the Lord said, "Go, for Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles and to kings, as well as to the people of Israel. And I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake." So Ananias went and found Saul. He laid his hands on him and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Instantly, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he got up and was baptized. Afterwards, he ate some food and regained his strength. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So let us begin our part in the work of Easter. As we are reminded in the book of Acts that we will study in the weeks ahead, we are sent to continue what Jesus started with his disciples, continues in us, and reminds us that we are sent to be the hands and feet of Christ in the world, because we know nothing will ever be the same because of Jesus' death and resurrection. Many of you know I grew up in the Atlanta metro area. I lived there since I was in high school till just after Victoria was born. One of the adventures you were always drawn into seeing with sign after sign after sign in North Georgia or as you were driving to Nashville, Tennessee was Ruby Falls. I remember counting the signs, counting them when I was a kid driving to Grandma and Grandpa's house in Northern Indiana, or when my mom took me back to college in Southern Indiana. I knew I was getting closer to home when there were more and more signs. Jeff and I finally got to check it out just before we moved to Minnesota to serve my first church, and it was a fun adventure. We got to see Rock City with a walk to see seven states and some very thin walk paths to get to Ruby Falls. And then we were blessed to see even more of the gifts of God's creation. When we finally approached Ruby Falls in the caves, you could hear the water, and as we slowly came into the area, feeling our way around in complete darkness, only with guardrails to help us, we all found our places to be. And then we heard a voice telling us the history of the falls, and then suddenly a flood of light shone down all around us, and ta-da! There it was in front of us, Ruby Falls. It was quite the transformation. In that moment between darkness and light, the light kind of blinded us and disoriented us. It was disruptive for a few moments. It took my eyes a little bit to adjust to the light to see the new perspective in front of me. In our story today, we encounter two people who had a moment like this. Both Saul and Ananias were walking in a form of darkness, and both had a disruptive encounter with light. My hope for us today is that we too might know what disruption is all about and how our current disruption in the church might be an opportunity, just like Saul, to transform the church again in a whole new way. Today in our Acts story, we meet leaders that God is about to do amazing work through. Yet we would not imagine
that these people would be people God would use. Yet we are reminded that God can do God's work through all kinds of people, even you and me. The first person we encounter is Saul. And a few important things we need to remember about Saul is that he was a Jewish man born in Tarsus, which was a Greek town, and it was far away from Jerusalem. He was a Roman citizen, and this was very rare for Jewish men. He chose to move to Jerusalem and train as a Pharisee. And remember, Pharisees were teachers of Moses' law, and he was a very devout follower. He followed everything to the letter of the law, and he loved Jerusalem so much that he was violently opposed to anyone who were false teachers against the law of God. He wanted to arrest both men and women and bring them to Jerusalem to be properly tried. Even with all of this, Saul's experience, a transformative experience on the road to Damascus. As he was determined to continue his mission of arresting false teachers, he was on the road, and a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. So he fell down to the ground. He heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Obviously, Jesus wanted to get his attention. He said his name twice, and Saul then says back, "Who are you, Lord?" And the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up, Saul, go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." You know, the people around Saul heard that voice, but they didn't see anyone. And finally, Saul got up off the ground, but yet when he opened his eyes, he was blind. But yet his companions helped lead him into Damascus, and he remained blind for 3 days, and he didn't eat or drink. He was in this major spiritual disruption, this moment, because in the midst of the darkness and this disruption, Saul had time to realize that this blindness was a personal lesson, this sign to Saul from Jesus. It was to impress upon him that he had to allow himself to be blind. He was blind to Jesus' ways before. So now for a time, he will be blinded by all the things that are happening. And when the eyes of his heart see the truth, the way, the truth, and the life in Jesus, then the eyes of his flesh will be able to see again. This is the transforming spirit at work in Saul's heart and his soul and his mind. The second person we encounter in Ananias is Ananias, who was already a believer in Damascus, doing his work. And the Lord spoke to Ananias in a vision. "Ananias, yes, Lord," he replied. "Go over to Straight Street, to a house of Judas, where you, when you get there, ask for the man of Tarsus named Saul. He is praying to me right now. I have shown him a vision of you coming to lay your hands on him so he can see again." And Ananias is like, "But Lord, not me. I've heard people talk about this terrible man and what he's doing to believers. And he is authorized by the leading priest to arrest us if we call upon your name." You know what? I don't know about you, but could you imagine being in Ananias' shoes? You are a disciple of Jesus. You have heard that Saul is on a rampage and he's killing people before, and you and your family could be possibly next. How open are you to be the Lord's messenger, laying hands on Saul, especially with this kind of disruption? How would people treat you if you helped this kind of person? "So I'm not sure about this," Ananias is saying. "Things are totally different. I could lose my standing in society. Why me, Lord?" But the Lord said, "Go, for Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to all. Go." So he goes. The Lord is pushy in this interaction. This Lord is the Jesus, the risen Christ we meet each and every day, sometimes seeing it right away and sometimes not. Saul encounters the Lord through the blinding light and a voice calling his name to get his attention. Ananias also encounters the Lord in a vision and calling his name and telling him to go. It is important to recognize that this interaction with the Lord, the risen Christ, reminds us of God's power and promise of resurrection, of new life being at work, of coming out of a pandemic and finding a new way of being the church, a new road, per se. That we can hold on to knowing there is peace, peace beyond fear, and there is healing for our country, beyond the boundaries of race and religion and politics and the pandemic. Because the risen Christ is right in our midst, in our brokenness, flipping the Ruby LaFalls light switches on the reality of our darkness and the disruptions in our world, so that we can start to see the beautiful opportunities that God has placed right in front of us, right around us all the time. Just like the unexpected gift of Ruby Falls that I got to experience with Jeff. Today, we are reminded how the risen Christ transformed two people. How Ananias went and found Saul, laid his hands on him and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and to be filled with the Spirit." Then instantly, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he regained his sight. And because of this, Saul got up, he was baptized, he believed, and he was transformed. He had new direction, a new journey, a new road. So do you see it? As Ananias laid his hands on Saul and calls him brother, proclaims Jesus' name, and that he was sent so Saul could see again, to be transformed, to see a new way. What is exciting is through all of this, we experience Saul's movement from one way into disruption and to the way of Jesus, and that he is baptized into his name and brought into the community of the very people he was determined to kill. That's transformation. Both of these people were hunkered down by the ways of the world, and as they experienced the risen Christ, something like scales fell from their eyes, and they started to see the world, their lives in a new way, the way that God chose them, how God calls us, and how God's name is proclaimed as God does in new things in light of the resurrection of Jesus. This new way of Jesus is crucial in moving forward. And the gospel reading today reminds us of that. To love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. That's what Ananias did today. So how are we letting the risen Christ work at transforming us and the church right now? To let something like scales fall from our eyes as well, so that we can start to see the church, the world, and each other in a new way, the way of Jesus, and to love one another. Whether we want to believe it or not, the church has rapidly transformed in the past 14 months, and it will never be the same. Online church and live streaming church are here to stay. A more digital platform will be something we will have to start adjusting to. We will probably never get back to the how things used to be, and we don't exactly know what's next. We need to prayerfully work together on how we see LCR being part of the Racine community in the future, how we will engage children and families in Sunday school this fall, how to re-engage worship as we continue to adjust due to CDC guidelines changing. Also, how will we reach out in new ways with the love of Jesus to one another, to families and the community around us? Because the church during this COVID disruption has had to make some big adjustments, some that people liked, some that people didn't like, some that people just rolled with, and now we are trying to figure out what the church will be like for today, tomorrow, and into the future. One thing is for sure, it certainly will be led by the Lord, the risen Christ, continuing to be in our midst, on the road with us, finding us in all kinds of places, and continuing to call our names, to go, to be disciples, even when we don't think it's possible. This will never stop. May we be open and willing to be like Saul and Ananias, even when we may be a little uncomfortable, to go out, enter new places, meet new people on roads that we don't expect, and lay hands on people. That's what building relationships is all about, so that we can address one another by name and invite people to have a relationship with Jesus for the first time and change lives. Today, I invite you to think about how God is at work through you, to take our no ways, I can't do that, and our we've never done it that way before, and transform them into yeses or sure, or can I join you? Because just like Saul and Ananias' new vision, God is walking with you as the Holy Spirit is at work, rearranging our way of seeing, being, and acting as the church for today and tomorrow. So are you ready? Are you ready to let those scales drop, to let the light blind you, to get up and go and see what God has in store? I pray you are, because as we do, our joy will be completed in what Jesus can do in you and through you. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, my debts are free. My good, my Savior is ransomed me. This bread of love is my series, burning in love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His
At this time, we have an opportunity to give thanks to God for the gifts which we have first received. Thank you for continuing to support the congregation with your prayers and offerings, however you are able to share them. Let us pray. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we have given and those received. Teach us to continue to be generous, giving fully of ourselves, and sending us in service to a broken world. that we may truly be the body of Christ in this community and beyond. Amen.
The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again and ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The prayers of the people. Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Praise to you for your power revealed in the resurrection. Fill your church with the power of your love that is stronger than death. Send us to tell the good news of Jesus wherever death holds its grip. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for your life at work in the resurrection. Fill all of creation with your love and send us forward in hope to the day that by your mercy all things in creation will be renewed and restored. Give us and all the world leaders courage to lead all nations in compassionate care and to assist us in the healing of all creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the peace that made possible in the resurrection. Fill the nations with your peace. Draw together people and leaders of all nations and languages. Reveal new possibilities and inspire new beginnings centered in peace and justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the hope of the resurrection. Fill in all need with hope. Be with those who are continued to administer the COVID vaccines, who are struggling, those who are dying, and those who grieve. We pray today for those in our congregation and beyond who need your healing spirit upon them. Jack, Robert, Jean, Rayanne, Scott, Pastor Cara, Mark and Nancy, Bill, Don, Sandy and Earl, and Hazel, Sandy, Jim, Kit, Mel, Jackie, Julie, and Shirley. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the gifts of mothers who have brought us into the world of the resurrection. Fill us with love, knowing that as mothers comfort their child, you comfort us. Bless mothers and mothering people in our lives. Comfort those who miss their mothers, mothers who grieve, those who grieve because they cannot be mothers, and those who have never known a loving mother. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for your faithfulness revealed in the resurrection. Fill us with trust that we join with all saints who have gone before us in proclaiming your mercy endures forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
At this time, we are blessed to celebrate Holy Communion together. Even though we are physically separated, we know that God connects us together spiritually in all times and places. Blessed people of God, this is not my table. It's not your table. It's not our table. But it's Christ's table. And because it's Christ's table, all of us are welcome here. At this table, you don't have to look a certain way, worship a certain way, or love a certain way. You just have to come, exactly as you are, seeking the one who is seeking you. So come, all of you, not because you must, but because you may, and here find forgiveness, healing, and wholeness for your journey. We remember together Jesus' final meal with his disciples. And on that night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to all his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is now a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me."
And so we are reminded that bless this bread and wine along with all of us in the eating and drinking at this table and at your tables at home, that our eyes may be opened, that we may recognize the risen Christ in our midst and in each other. With great joy this morning, I proclaim in Jesus' name that these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready. Amen. Now I invite all of us to join together in the Lord's Prayer, either praying the contemporary prayer or the traditional prayer together in whatever language you're comfortable with. But we pray together as we prepare to share in this meal with one another. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
At this time, please bring out your pre-sealed communion cups you may have picked up from church. They are bread and grape juice. Or collect whatever bread, juice, and wine you have at home at this time for our meal. Because together we will share in God's word, Christ's promise, and the blessings and grace of this meal. Take and eat. The body of Christ, given for you. Take and drink. The blood of Christ, shed for you. While we share in Holy Communion, we are blessed with our communion song.
Receive.
Receive now this blessing of our God. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Jesus. The God of life, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. We conclude with our sending song.
Now we are blessed to be sent out today to go out into the world, to know that we are called to share the message and to go in peace as we share the resurrection by loving Jesus, changing lives, and reaching out to serve. Thanks be to God. Amen.